are some of the symptoms of stage 1 colorectal cancer? What does treatment look like? In today's video, I'm going to be talking with stage 1 survivor Evan about these questions and more. This video is part 1 of a special series that I'm doing for Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month, where I'm interviewing other survivors of this crappy disease from stage 1 all the way through stage 4. Before we dive in, let me introduce myself really quick. My name is Jelena, and I was diagnosed with stage 3 rectal cancer at age 34. I created this channel, Life as a Cancer Survivor, to talk all about colorectal cancer, what treatment is like, and how life just doesn't return back to normal once treatment is over. If you like what you're hearing so far, click on the subscribe button down here and make sure that you click on the bell to receive notifications so you'll never miss any of my latest videos. Now let's talk with Evan. All right, well, welcome, Evan. First, before we get into this too much, can you tell us a little bit about yourself pre-cancer?
Yes, I can, Jelena, and thank you for asking. So pre-cancer, my situation was that basically I was a spouse and caregiver of a severely disabled spouse who was suffering from secondary progressive multiple sclerosis, confined to a bed or a wheelchair, and had a lot of responsibilities on my plate. That also made me a single parent. I was trying to raise and take care of our daughter because my wife really couldn't participate in that anymore. In addition to just being a brother, a family member, a son, I just lost my job and trying to navigate my career. But otherwise, hey, I had a great healthy Colorado lifestyle, mountain biking, trail running, climbing mountains, skiing in the winter. So that was kind of, me pre-cancer. So, kind of typical life with some twists and turns, and then this came along.
Okay. So did you experience any symptoms leading up to your diagnosis?
I did not. So I was completely asymptomatic, and I really at that time didn't even know much about colon cancer or really understand its ramifications. I was basically living in a world of ignorance. But I was also, kind of the classic case study where I was over the screening age of 50. I was 52 at the time, so I was overdue for my screening. And by the way, I didn't know that I had family history. And because my family didn't like to talk about that, as a lot of families don't. And so you don't ask, you don't tell. And then to find out after my diagnosis that I did have family history and I really should have my screening done at age 40 was really eye-opening for me.
Okay. So then since you didn't have any symptoms, how did you end up being diagnosed? Did you finally make it in for that routine screening colonoscopy?
Yes. So I basically, finally, I got a job. So I didn't have any healthcare benefits. I've got a disabled spouse and a young daughter, and I'm trying to keep the family life in order and trying to get my career back on track. And I finally got a job after being out of my industry for a few years, which brought healthcare benefits along. And then that gave me an opportunity to say, okay, family, let's go. We got to get physicals done. We got to get in to see the dentist, all these life things that slip away when you don't have healthcare insurance. So healthcare insurance is very important. So I went in for a routine physical, and my internal medicine physician looked at me and said, hey, good to see you, but where have you been? It's been like 6 years and haven't seen you. You're overdue for a lot of stuff, including, oh, by the way, you're 52 now. You should have had your colonoscopy at 50. Do you have any idea? Do you have any family history of any gastric problems, colon problems, et cetera? And fortunately, thank God for her, because she really kicked me in the butt. And she actually had a brother who died from colon cancer. And she looked at me, she said, you look like the perfect bill of health, just like my brother did. And then he got his colonoscopy and they found something. So she said, I'm not going to take any ifs, ands, buts about it. I want you within 2 weeks, I'm going to refer you over to this GI screening center. They're a mile from here. You're going to get your colonoscopy. It's going to be quick and easy. Not a big deal. Go get it done. And thank God for her that she was so persistent, because being a guy, I would have probably blown it off. And I probably would have been like, yeah, I'll do that in 6 months. And that would have drawn out to a year. And then, sure enough, I go in you know, it was within 2 weeks and she made me do it. And she was really persistent and her office called to follow up. And I got my colonoscopy scheduled. And I went in and the GI guy that did my colonoscopy came out, and instead of smiles and high fives, he had this somber look on his face. And he said, "Hey, you know, man, I wish I had better news, but we found some things and you need to go find a medical oncologist and get your things in order." And my jaw just hit the table. And I looked around, I'm like, "You talking to me?" Like, "No, you gotta be talking about that big fat guy that was smoking cigarettes in the parking lot before I came in here. You're talking about him, right? Like, not me. Like, no, I'm a trail runner. I'm an athlete. I'm, you know, I ride my bike over 3,000 miles a year. You know, you can't be talking about me." But he was, and they found multiple tumors.
So then what was your ultimate diagnosis?
So I was diagnosed. So he found multiple tumors, of unknown origin. He said, "They got to go to pathology. You got to figure out what these things are." But we got two of them and they looked different. And sure enough, they came back and they diagnosed me with neuroendocrine tumors. And they were complex and unrelated and in different places in my colon. And, you know, which kind of raised suspicion that there might be other issues going on. So anyway, so that's where my journey started. And I had to go find the best medical oncologist I could find and group and did my research and started my journey from there.
Okay. So then what stage was that classified as?
I got really lucky. And the way that they put it was that, fortunately, I had the slow and dumb kind of tumors. And I'm thinking, oh, perfect for me. I got the slow and dumb tumors. Thank goodness. They match up with my personality. And so they diagnosed me as a stage one neuroendocrine tumor candidate. And that's kind of where my journey began. And I had two different surgical procedures to get those neuroendocrine tumors out. And then different from what they used to do, they stopped there. So I found the best multidisciplinary cancer center I could at the University of Colorado here and some people that specialize in these types of tumors. And so they did the surgery and they said, you know, "We're going to stop." And I kind of expected it was going to go into chemo, radiation, and who knows what else, because neuroendocrine tumors are a very different type of beast. And you can have this thing called neuroendocrine syndrome because they kind of spread in different ways through your neuroendocrine system. But they basically took what they call an aggressive conservative stance and they decided just to stop. So stage one, we're stopping with you. We're gonna observe you for the next 6 months, year, out to 3 years and see how this thing goes and determine next steps.
Okay. So then your treatment plan consisted just of surgeries to get rid of the tumors?
Yeah. So my treatment plan included basically two procedures where they removed the tumors. And then I was back at the university every 6 months for a barrage of diagnostic tests to try to figure out where else these neuroendocrine tumors might have gone. And fortunately, thank God, they didn't discover them anywhere else. And they stopped there. And now, you know, my follow-up has been, literally my final follow-up was about 6 months ago. That was my 3-year point. And at that point, they just said, you know, we've got no further evidence of disease. It doesn't mean that these neuroendocrine tumors aren't somewhere else, but at this point, we're just going to call you a stage one survivor. And if you have any symptoms, let us know. I've got my 1-year follow-up coming up in a few months to ensure that they haven't spread elsewhere. But so far, I think I'm out of the woods.
Okay, awesome. Yeah. Great. Hope so. So then for that follow-up monitoring, what kind of tests did they do? Did they run blood tests? Did they have you do any kinds of scans?
I've been through more colonoscopies in the last 3.5 years than I care to discuss. In addition to CTs and MRIs, constant blood work, and a number of other things. So, They've used all the technology that they can, because neuroendocrine tumors can spread in different ways and affect the body in different ways and present themselves in different ways. It's a more complex tumor type. And although it's less aggressive, which was really important in my case, because my medical oncologist basically said, you probably have had those tumors for at least 10 years. He said, if it was another type of tumor, you most likely would be dead by now. So he said, you're lucky that you broke the rules, got away with it with these types of tumors, because you made it 10 years, before coming to see us. And that was really, that was really just by the grace of God, I'm still here to tell this story. And that's why I like telling this story, because I'm not the example anybody should follow, because number one, my family history, I should have gone through my colonoscopy and diagnostic work much earlier in my life. And so I'm just lucky that I ended up with these neuroendocrine tumors that were more slow growing.
Yeah. So is the colon the common place where these neuroendocrine tumors will form, or are there other places that also are they're commonly found?
My understanding is they're most common in the rectum and in the colon. If they're further up in the small or large intestine, which they can be, that's where they typically go undiscovered until you become symptomatic with this neuroendocrine syndrome, which gets very complicated, because then by then it's spread to other organs.
So now you've gone through treatment. So you've decided to get involved more in advocacy and spreading awareness. So what got you involved in that?
Yeah, good question. And for me, really a no-brainer. For me, basically what happened was, so I got diagnosed, I went through all this stuff, had this traumatic experience. No one wants to hear the words, you have cancer. I didn't hear anything the guy said after that. He said, we found some tumors and you got to go get your things in order. That's all I heard. And then I'm thinking, okay, how am I going to tell my daughter, who's in high school at the time? How am I going to tell her, basically her single parent, she depends upon me. I'm her rock. I just fell apart. I was in tears. I was a mess. And so in any event, so I started posting stuff online. I started doing a lot of homework online, a lot of research to figure out what is this thing growing in me and what does it mean to me? And through my whole journey, I was doing a lot of stuff, through social media. And actually somebody from Fight CRC saw one of my posts and contacted me. And that's what connected me to the Fight CRC Foundation out of Springfield, Missouri. And then because I live in Colorado, one thing led to another. And they said, hey, there's some guys that are talking about coming out to Colorado to start this climb thing, for our organization to raise awareness. And then that, I said, absolutely, let me do everything I can, because I'm a stage one survivor. And then they also told me about this ambassador program, which I immediately signed up for. And, basically the way I looked at it is I said, okay, I just got to get out of jail free card. By the grace of God, I'm a stage one survivor. And I was learning and reading about and hearing all these stories about, stage, two, three, four colorectal cancer patients and the horrors that this disease can bring. And I just felt like, there was a reason why I was diagnosed with stage one, which gave me a lot of sense of purpose, which for me, there's no question that I was going to get involved with Fight CRC and anybody else I could help out with. I reached out to the university, got involved in the Colorado Cancer Coalition, and joined a colorectal cancer task force, and I'm doing some advocacy work for them here locally in the state. I immediately rolled up my sleeves and I continue to do advocacy work, because there's a reason why I'm still here. And just 3 years ago, when I went through ambassador training with Fight CRC, half of my class that I was training with and I was working on behalf of and with and doing advocacy work with, they're gone now. And it drives me even further to realize that I've got to step up and do everything I can. Because I'm a lucky stage one cancer survivor, and there's a lot of people that aren't as lucky as I am. And there's a lot of people out there that are just like me that haven't been diagnosed yet, that haven't been screened yet, that don't want to go see the doctor, that, are embarrassed to talk about symptoms they're having if they're having symptoms, and need to hear my story and other stories that will hopefully compel people to go get screened so that they don't end up, with a negative outcome.
Yeah. So you mentioned in that you were kind of part of the original team that created Fight Colorectal Cancer's annual Climb for a Cure. So can you talk a little bit more about how that team formed and a little bit more about the climb itself?
Yeah. So Chris Ganser and some guys back east, you know, thought it was a great idea to come out to Colorado and pick one of the biggest peaks in the state, Long's Peak at 14,255 feet above sea level, come out from sea level and go climb this mountain. And I said, guys, we may want to start small and work our way up to something bigger, but they were all fired up and they kind of picked it out. And I'm like, well, let's go. I've climbed it before and I'd love to be a part of it and meet you guys. We hadn't met yet, except for, you know, virtually on phone calls and stuff. And that was the inception of it. I mean, there were just a handful of us. My daughter and I went and met these guys. They all flew in and literally went straight up to Long's Peak up by Estes Park from sea level. And, you know, we camped out overnight and, you know, and it was a long 15-hour day. And, you know, it was a rough first experience and a learning experience for all of us because, you know, for my daughter and I, it wasn't such a big deal because we climbed 14ers in Colorado on a regular basis and we were in good shape and acclimated to the altitude, but these poor guys were not. But it sparked the fire that now has become, you know, Climb for a Cure, which is kind of the premier philanthropic event for Fight Colorectal Cancer Foundation, just keeps growing every year. And we started the first year and I think there were, you know, I think there were 8-10 of us. And, you know, in the last live event that we had before the pandemic started last year, we had over 120 people show up in Colorado for this event, which blew our minds. And then we were supposed to go to, you know, Tahoe in California last year. And we had almost twice that number of people registered for that event. So it just keeps growing. And our dream was in the beginning that, you know, how do we come up with like a unique, cool event for Fight CRC? You know, it's different from every other society that does like a walk or, you know, does like a bike event or, you know, these other, maybe a marathon or a 5K or whatever. So the climb thing was something we all kind of latched onto and we thought, you know, maybe we could build this up and eventually like climb Denali, for example, in Alaska, which was Chris Ganser's dream and idea. I would fully sign up for that. Unfortunately, Chris lost his battle and we kind of carry this on in his honor now. And there's a scholarship foundation set up for Chris and young family members that are dealing with colorectal cancer. But, you know, I hope someday maybe we can get to that point where we do have a small select group that wants to take on a big adventure like climbing Denali. But in the meantime, you know, we're going to continue this event year over year and find places or as it grows, you know, do maybe localized regional events and have multiple climbs around the country and bring more people into this that have a passion for the outdoors and want to support a great cause and what we're doing at the Fight Colorectal Cancer Foundation.
So can you talk a little about how connecting with other cancer survivors has kind of helped you along the way, and even like after cancer has been over, how that's helped you?
Well, you know, for me initially, it really helped me to understand, you know, what my potential journey could look like. So as I got into it, you know, that's all I wanted to do. I wanted to talk to other people, like who else has these neuroendocrine tumors? You know, how do I find, you know, a group, a social group, an online group, a chat group, a Facebook group that's suffering from colorectal cancer with this specific kind of crazy tumor I've never heard of, number one. And then, you know, and then number two, you know, just in general, understand like what does this colorectal cancer journey look like, you know, for most people from stage one to stage four. And to help me get an understanding of, you know, what I can expect. Can I do anything about it? No, I've already been diagnosed and the card has been dealt to me. Now I got to deal with it. But it was really helpful connecting with people that are going through the journey or were ahead of me in the journey. And that's where becoming an ambassador for Fight CRC really helped out because I was exposed to everybody from other stage one survivors to stage four survivors that were battling for their lives. That are now no longer here. And really a lot of the work I'm doing now is in their honor because, you know, they helped me with insight as to what the disease can or cannot look like and how they were handling it emotionally and physically, you know, and then, you know, so anyway, it's really important to connect with others that are dealing with the same thing you're dealing with from from really start to finish. And now still being connected to this community has really gave me a tremendous sense of purpose and a responsibility to, you know, to continue to spread the word and educate and do whatever I can, use my skills in life, my professional skills, to share my story and to do work out there and give my time and expertise to educate the next generation so that hopefully we can continue to bring these statistics down for colon cancer, which as the number two cancer killer in men and women, it shouldn't be, because, you know, next to skin cancer, a melanoma on the surface of your skin, colon cancer can be seen through a colonoscopy and effectively treated and addressed quickly. It's one of those types of cancers that if we catch it early, it can be treated, and the severity, the outcome, the morbidity and the mortality, can either be reduced or even delayed. And that makes colon cancer unique. And that's why we need to talk about it. That's why I'm here to talk about it. And that's why I'm going to continue talking about it and advocating legislators for healthcare policy to ensure that people can get access to colonoscopies, because insurance is a whole other can of worms that insurance companies try to tell us that you can only get your colonoscopy if A, B, and C, or if you're over a certain age. And we're trying to remove a lot of those barriers so more people get access to colonoscopies and screening. So yeah, my journey, it's been interesting. And I don't want to be a role model for anybody because I broke all the rules. But I do want, guys to know that, that we need to do our part and get screened and get our healthcare in order.
You had mentioned also that you wanted to talk a little bit about like survivor's guilt, and you kind of threw a little bit in there while you were talking. Was there more stuff that you wanted to talk about that topic?
Cancer is a big mean word and a scary word, and it's a scary disease. And I've got a close friend through fight colorectal cancer and the climb and the foundation that is also a stage one survivor. And Brian and I talk about this a lot, that, why us? And why do we have stage one colon cancer, not stage four, like, the other people that we met through our journey? And that's, that's hard. It's hard to swallow. It's hard to understand. I'm a man of faith, and I believe God works in mysterious ways. And that's why I'm so passionate about doing everything I can for this organization, for this disease state, for people that are suffering from colon cancer and really any kind of cancer, because I'm lucky. I got this label that I'm stage one, whatever that means. But what comes with that too is the guilt and the sense of responsibility and the feelings of remorse for those that have lost their battle. And I've seen, and I've had friends that have lost their battle very quickly, that seemed healthy yesterday, and then 6 months later, are basically unable to get out of bed and have lost their battle and are moving towards hospice with colon cancer. And that's a heartbreaker, for me. I can't help but feel like, why not me? Like, why him? He's got four kids. I got one kid. Take me, not him. You get a lot of all kinds of crazy thoughts about it. And I guess it's probably no different than anybody that, suffers the trauma of a near-death experience, whether it's a disease or a really bad car accident and the person in the car next to you died and you didn't. Cancer's kind of the same way in that, why did these people die and I didn't? Why are they sicker than I am and I'm not? But again, I think the Lord works in mysterious ways. And I've been given a special pass and a special purpose that, for as long as I can breathe in my life, I'm gonna be an advocate and a proponent, and I'm gonna work hard and do everything I can with my skill set to fight for the next generation that gets this disease.
Thank you, Evan, for taking the time to share your story with us. Evan's story is exactly why you need to go in on time for your colonoscopy screening, even if you aren't experiencing symptoms. Timely screening can be the difference between life or death. In case you don't know, the screening age has recently been lowered and it is now 45. So if you're 45 or older, once this video is over, you need to call your doctor to get the ball rolling on scheduling your screening. If you're low risk, you might even be eligible for taking one of the at-home screening tests, and it doesn't require any colonoscopy prep at all. But even if your doctor is recommending the colonoscopy, that prep, it's a lot easier than going through treatment for late-stage colorectal cancer. If you want to know more about what exactly going through that colonoscopy prep is like, you can watch my video up here of what it was like for me. Keep tuning in every Friday this March to follow the stories of survivors from stage 2 through stage 4. Thank you for watching.